Welcome, everybody. My main emphasis today is not isn't really anti-Semitism or anti-Israelism, but first of all to understand what's going on in Europe. I'm speaking about Europe yesterday because every day it changes. I didn't know whether Theresa May still would be Prime Minister of England today when I read. Okay, look. Let's assume that Chaya had said to me, sorry, you made a mistake, you have a minute to present your case. What would I have said? I would have in essence said that out of this enormous mass of information, what are the things which mainly count? First of all, Germany is the main state in Europe. It dominates the European Union. The developments in Germany and the disastrous decision of Mrs. Merkel to let in endless number of immigrants which Germany cannot cope with. And that has an impact on the whole of the European Union. The second thing is the developments on Brexit, which so far we have mainly seen words, insults, threats. If I'll discuss Brexit in more detail, because in essence, the essence of what has happened so far in Brexit can really be summarized in a few words. Many things are going to come, but not much has come yet. Third thing is, in the long term, and not in France, and I'll discuss that, France is the sick man of Europe. I'll show that. But France is important not for the short term, even if Mr. Macron would like to give the impression that France is a terribly important country. But France is important because it has the highest Muslim population. It's there where the Muslim problem will reach its real summit earlier than probably in any other European countries. France has 751 so-called sensitive urban zones, which in plain English translates as no-go areas. So that's, now, if you are given a minute, you always steal another minute. So that I would like to use what Israel should be doing. Well, the first thing is, there is nobody in Israel who has the faintest idea of how the battlefield of anti-Semitism, in particular anti-Israelism, looks in the world in an orderly way. Of course, everybody knows fragment, but it's this absurdity of Israel not being able to deal with the attacks in an orderly manner. So we need a counter-propaganda agency. The Foreign Office in its present form cannot develop what happens in particular in certain Western European countries. Because what's the problem? I mean, you sent a few ex-ambassadors here. You sent an ambassador to a country of which he, in particular, if it's not in English, knows very little because he doesn't speak the language. The old days of when Israel was established, when we had people who spoke all kinds of languages, and you could send to countries. We sent even to a major country like Germany now, somebody who doesn't speak German. We have sent to France an ambassador who didn't speak French. These are the signs of the times. And obviously, if Yama said it rightly, if you know a language of a country, that's a totally other ball game. And on the inside, the ministry has no, makes their people who refer to them also know nothing about the country because they are also rotated. And you can't work that way in today's rapidly changing reality of Europe. You need in the Foreign Office for countries, for areas like Scandinavia, France, the Netherlands, Belgium, you need people who speak these languages, who follow these countries on a permanent basis, even if most of their life they stay in the Foreign Office, because what happens today goes so fast that, I mean, if The original idea was that I would speak in September. Catalonia's independence didn't exist. Wasn't an issue. I'll not deal with that today because I'll focus on the key issues. The other thing we have is we see a decline in globalization, an increase in sovereignty, of which Trump, of course, is a typical example. Brexit is a typical example. And we see the beginning of an understanding of greater Israeli sovereignty. That has consequences. We don't want all these foreigners to meddle in our affairs. They should first of all run their own affairs properly, and I'll come to that. And that means also that we shouldn't meddle in anybody else's affairs unless it concerns the Jewish community. And that is also why I think the Israeli government was extremely wise to not express an opinion on Catalonia, even though the French, the Spanish government asked it to. Okay, those who want to go now, having heard the essence. Okay, let's see what we are talking about. The European Union today, before Brexit, has 512 million people, and it's about 200 times the size of Israel as far as geography is concerned. That leads us to a very, we have 8.5 million. That is not a fair game. And for that reason, we have an interest that the European Union is weakened as much as possible. Because I'm not necessarily saying that it should be abandoned. Anyhow, even if it will be abandoned, then still many of the collaboration programs, such as Horizon, the research programs, will still continue. But if we start analyzing the 28, or let's even say the 27 countries after the UK goes out, then you come to the conclusion that if we were a member of the European Union, we were a middle-sized country. As if I counted rightly, only 8, or after the UK goes, 7 of the 27 countries have more significantly more population than we have. I mean, Sweden, Belgium, these are countries who have perhaps a million more, but that's irrelevant. Well, what is important, of course, is Germany, UK, temporarily, Italy, France, Spain, Poland, Romania, these are even the Netherlands, which is twice as our population. These are countries which are much bigger. The rest is either our size, and there are at least 10 who are far smaller. Now, before I get into Europe, I want to, there are of course phenomena playing in society which have nothing to do with countries, which have to do with the cultural, technological developments in our society. The first is postmodernism, which is a word which already makes people cringe. So let me translate that, everything fragments. And this fragmentation, look, I sometimes say when I speak about anti-Semitism, as Fiamma already spoke about the Renaissance, if you had invited me 500 years ago, it would be easy. I would bring a Catholic priest. He'd say, "You have killed the son of the Lord. You're eternally responsible." I bring a Lutheran priest who says all the synagogues should be burned. And if you don't understand it, as a Jew, you are a hopeless case. But today, you have to speak an hour or 2 hours in order to convey the message what anti-Israelism is. In fact, I wrote a thick book about it. You can no longer presented in a simple way. And this fragmentation, which, look, what is postmodern? Postmodern says nothing. It only says that there was a defined period which was called modern, and now that period is over, and we live in a period which comes after it, of which we cannot define the content. Okay, globalization creates a confusion, of course. Society becomes more complex through technology, and that means that more and more people are marginalized, because if I look at my grandchildren, how they deal with a computer and with the internet and how I deal with it, there is no comparison. And that will be the case for their grandchildren as well. So this technology has a tremendously confusing base. Society also becomes more vulnerable. Because what is terrorism? One guy with a car can kill 70, 80 people like we have seen in Nice. And that is a sign of the vulnerability of society, which is vulnerable in many ways, because the more complex an entity, and in my old days as a consultant to major corporations, I always, when I came in somewhere, I hadn't a clue what they were doing. I always asked myself first, how do I bankrupt this place in order to understand where it was vulnerable? So in this whole reality, analysis becomes more difficult. And if you cannot analyze it, then you go in your perceptions. And perception becomes reality in that situation. And if perception becomes reality, as Mr. Trump has shown, fake news is, of course, you cannot check. Is it fake news? Is it real news? We Jews know that fake news goes back 2,000 years ago when we were accused of killing Jesus. But fake news now is widely spread. Now, can democracy survive? I have no doubt that democracy can survive, but it cannot survive as it is today. The liberal democracy of let things flow that will either go under or it will have to change. Governments, and that is the one thing which the neoconservatives in the United States saw very clearly, government can barely cope. You cannot burden the government with too many things because it has great difficulty to let society develop. Now, if democracy doesn't adapt, where are we going? We are not going. The two things which are we are being told will not happen. It's not going to be a real dictatorship in the Western world, and there is not going to be, and Islam is not going to take over. What is far more likely is that because government cannot cope, that we're going into increasingly chaotic situations. Okay. Threats to Israel, I have shown that on many occasions. I have four threats, four major threats. The first one is military. Well, if you are threatened by military, you put up defense forces and you invest in them, and the IDF is certainly one of the best armies in the world. You're threatened by intelligence, you put up your counterintelligence entities, the three entities we have, Mossad, Shabak, Amman. They are among the most sophisticated in the world. You are attacked by cyber. We invest heavily in cyber defense. We will be, in a few years, probably the leading force in cyber defense in the world. We are attacked by propaganda. We do nothing. It is simple, but that doesn't mean that Mr. Netanyahu has a great desire to do anything on this, even though he has been told by his own staff and by American Jewish leaders that that is the issue. Okay. Now, here we get to the heart of the matter. I have here the only country for which we have really statistics on this over a long period is Germany. And I hope you can read it. Yes. We start, Israel conducts a war of extermination against the Palestinians. We all think, or many people of us who think about this, think that war of extermination in German, Vernichtungskrieg, is something which comes out of the Second World War. It's absolutely not true. It comes from the beginning of the 20th century when the Germans tried to exterminate the Hereros in Southwest Africa. So it has a long background. And then we are acting with the Palestinians like Nazis acted toward the Jews. A large percentage of the German thinks that. And the And what do you see here? There is a new Germany, there's no doubt. There's also a small old Germany, neo-Nazis, people who are close to neo-Nazis. And there is a very important mutated Germany. That is not a new Germany. That is a Germany which now applies to Israel the same concept of absolute evil, because in our days, in the Nazis' days, to be subhuman was absolute evil. In the our days, to be absolute evil is to be a Nazi. So the Germans have these Germans, and we start with 68%, and we more or less at 40% now, of these Germans think that we are absolute evil. Now, I'm not a psychologist. For a psychologist, this is very simple. If everybody is guilty, then the Nazi guilt wasn't so bad. So there is a huge problem in Germany. And that shows why Mrs. Merkel was so wrong to increase the problem by this huge import of immigrants. Okay. On the other countries, we have on a few other countries statistics, and really these statistics, but this is only one investigation done by, on seven countries, done by the Bielefeld University in 2011. Then we have a study from Switzerland, and we have a study from Oslo. So you see more or less the lowest are 38%. The most of them are somewhere in the 40 to 50% range. And only Poland is far, far above. And then you say, where does this come from? And this reflects what goes on today in Europe. It's not so that the leading politicians, even though there have been three socialist politicians in the past, who have said that we behave like Nazis. All three were social democrats. The Swedish Prime Minister Olof Palme, the Greek Prime Minister Andreas Papandreou, and Mitterrand, the French president. But basically, you don't hear that from leading politicians. That means that the combination of political attitudes always condemning Israel, the media, the some churches, NGOs, trade unions, and the internet have created this evil, absolute evil image of Israel. And the European Union, before condemning if we put up another house somewhere on the West Bank, should better look, because this is a reflection of the evil Europe. Once you think that others are evil, absolute evil, that means that it is in your mind. Okay, that's the book which also recommends the establishment of a counter-propaganda agency. Okay, now, what really characterizes the European Union? It's an open market, you have free movement of citizens. Part of countries have common currency, part of countries have open borders, the common research projects, in which Israel, by the way, participates. The Brussels bureaucracy is not elected. And that is one of the heart of the problems. Now, from all the people I have seen over the years, and what I hear about them, these are not stupid people. This is not a selection of underachievers. This is simply a selection of people who are remote from the citizens they represent. And that has shown itself over the years. Europe is dominated by the German, by the so-called German-French axis. This was true at a certain moment because let's say under Helmut Schmidt as German Chancellor, he knowingly wanted, in order because of Germany's war past, to give the French a greater vote. And in that way, you created this idea that these two countries were running the European Union, they were dominant. This is today a fiction. because France is a weak country, and even if Mr. Macron does a little bit of show off and travels around and makes statements, he has the greatest problems to get his house in order, and that's going to be a great problem for a couple of, at least for a couple of years. There is this discrepancy in wealth between north and south. I haven't mentioned the fourth largest country, Italy, in my introduction, because unless Italy runs into major financial problems, its role in the EU is relatively small to its size of its population. And Brexit, of course, is a huge challenge. At the end of the previous sentence, Mark Eiskens, who was the Minister of Foreign Affairs of Belgium, said this famous statement, Europe is an economic giant, political dwarf, military worm. And frankly speaking, not much has changed in those years. Okay, I always like Matt. This is my favorite cartoonist of the Daily Telegraph. It says, if it hadn't been for these EU directives in my breast pocket, the bullet would have gone straight through my heart. which shows you this enormous number of bureaucracy. This is one of the best cartoons I have seen on European bureaucracy. Okay, now what are the problems? First of all, the bureaucracy. The bureaucracy is incompetent in foreseeing problems. The euro is ill-conceived. I mean, you cannot have a common currency without a common fiscal policy. I mean, this is exceptionally simple, and you don't need many years of study of economy to understand this basic. Still, that is what has been done, and it has created enormous problems. Of course, the victims, and they themselves are guilty, are the Greeks. Greece is a country which should never have entered, and I've worked for years in Greece. And even though I'm not a macroeconomist, I've more dealt with business than with national accounts. It was so obvious that this country is not competitive. And if you are not competitive, you devalue. That was true in a country where I've even worked more, in Italy. If you have a common currency, you cannot solve the one solution for being non-competitive, is that you devalue. Now, the Germans have developed a giant trade surplus, one of the most competitive countries in Europe. And there is no way to get rid of it. And if you look at the great surplus of trade surplus of the EU, then you see that it's almost identical to the surplus of Germany. So Schengen is, without the proper external border guarding, is of course an idiotic idea. If you have, you say, everybody can travel everywhere, but then I guard my external borders very strongly, And it's for me extremely convenient. You come into the EU, you pass one control, and then you move between the countries. Schengen is nice, but Schengen isn't efficient. Now, we had here, not so long ago, the coordinator of dealing with terrorism of the EU. And he tried to explain to us that despite that, the Europe now has its matters under control. It controls all these border passages. Well, a few weeks later, I went to Switzerland, and we took a car, and we drove from, if you go around the Lake of Geneva, then you drive from Switzerland into France. And yes, it's true, there were some French, but Switzerland's part of Schengen, that there were some French gendarmes at the crossing, but they waved us through. Then, if you go further on the way to Geneva, you come back to Switzerland. There was nobody there. Then I flew from Zurich to Paris. Nobody asked to see my passport in Zurich. I walked into France without anybody looking at it. Now, if you are so bloody negligent, then Schengen cannot work. And it doesn't work because terrorists move from one country to the other. The refugee problem. Look, it is obvious that the supply of refugees and immigrants to Europe is unlimited. It is also fairly obvious that with the Syrian war and the problems in Iraq going on for many years, that at a certain moment, some of these refugees would like to come into Europe. Now, the logical thing would have been to say, look, we will take in the Christians, we will take in the Yazidis, and, well, the Muslim world has 1.5 billion people, and they should take in the Muslim refugees. Well, then, okay, if Europe says this is a humanitarian problem, we will help finance them, would have been an excellent idea and also have saved money because what goes on today costs far more and is far less efficient and creates problems. There are limits to solidarity, of course. Macron and Merkel had this conversation. Yeah, we have to be to integrate the EU many more. But it is clear that the idea that you would that Germany would pay for the deficit of Italy, I mean the Greek deficit with all these countries you can manage, even though it's a disaster for Greece. If Greece had gone bankrupt, they would have been in an infinitely better situation, but the Europeans wouldn't be pleased. Now, I, having worked in Italy for decades, I saw there that the North was always subsidizing the South. Always. And the gap, all it did was stabilize the gap. It never shrunk. So this is not going to work, and it's not difficult to see to work. I'm not showing here any insights which anybody who knows a little bit cannot understand. Now Brexit is a huge challenge, and at the moment they play brinkmanship. And is Catalonian independence a lasting problem? Jeroen Dijsselbloem, the previous Dutch finance minister, said, which he got a lot of criticism for, I can't spend all my money on liquors and women and then go and ask for your support. What he said was, in fact, the northern countries who run their affairs properly cannot pay for the spendthrift of the southern European countries, which wasn't universally liked in the EU. Also cultural problems. Look, the EU, I mean, they say there is a Judeo-Christian civilization, which of course, in Europe, which of course is a fake. There is a Christian. One can think about Christianity what one wants, but it gives a common value. It is a value system which very clear values which, take the Protestants, take the Catholics, but still there is a base of a value system. You take that value system away, you get secularization. Now, I am not saying that secular people cannot be moral. You can be highly moral, you can be more moral than religious people. But that's not the problem. The problem is that anything goes. You don't have to stick to certain morals because there is no common value system. The low birth rate, and that pushes you to bring in migrants who cause you sometimes more problems if you don't bring in the right migrants. So loss of common values. Then you get the rise of populism. That's why I wanted to do that introductory page at the beginning. If perception becomes reality, if you can do fake news, then also a populist can say whatever he wants, because nobody can check the truth, so nobody can also check the falsehood. Then you are getting a militant extreme, left, and part of the Muslim immigrants do not want to integrate. There is a tremendous difference between Eastern European immigrants into Western European countries who do not want to change society. They either want to earn money and go home, like the greatest idea of the Greeks and the Turks, the southern Italians who came to work in the northern countries, was to collect enough money in order to have money for a cab in their hometowns and go back. They wanted to go back or alternatively assimilate. Here you have people who specifically do not want to assimilate. One of the, perhaps the only country where you have a Muslim party in parliament is the Netherlands. These people say we do not want to integrate our cultural values, and they have Turkish passports, they vote in the Turkish elections, predominantly in favor of Erdogan, who certainly not compatible with Dutch democracy. So you have this this problem. Now, as far as Jews are concerned, and that is not something you'll ever hear a Jewish leader in Europe to say, the massive non-selective immigration of Muslims into Europe is the most negative event for European Jews and Israel in the past 50 years. Now, I'm in the process of finishing an article on the Mehra brothers. Mohammed Mehra killed in 2012 three French soldiers, four Jews. His brother was just condemned to 5 years later for help to him to 20 years of jail. If you check one of the brothers who wrote the book on how they were educated. They were educated by people from Algeria, by parents from Algeria who educated them as fanatic anti-Semites. So why did the French let in the parents of the Mehra brothers? Because there is no checking. And in the beginning, only Jews were killed. Of course, after the Paris murders, Charlie Hebdo murders, the Paris Bataclan and so on murders, the Nice murders, it has now come home to the French themselves. So they didn't betray only their Jewish citizens. By now, they have also betrayed their own citizens. We have to talk a moment about Islam and Islamization, because it's a genuine issue. Now, there's this French writer, Michel Houellebecq, who got a tremendous success in 2005 when he wrote his book, which translates into English as Submission. Houellebecq, the book came out on the day of Charlie Hebdo, of the Charlie Hebdo murders. The basic idea of Houellebecq is simple. Hollande will stay for a second term. It will be such a tremendous mess that in the elections you have on the one hand the fascists and on the other hand a Muslim candidate. The public at large thinks that the Muslim candidate is the lesser evil, and you get the Muslim president and France is Islamized. Of course, this is a fantasy, and this fantasy is interesting as a concept, but it has no, Europe is not going to be Islamized for a very simple reason, because the anti-Islam is growing obviously faster than Islam. Now, we speak about Islamization as if it is one simple phenomenon. There are five types of what you might call related to Islamization. There's the normal Islamization. If you bring in a country 5% of a population, part of which are religious Muslims, you have to put up mosques, and mosques are building in a public domain, and that changes the public domain, and there is nothing wrong with that. And these people, if it are not burqas or niqabs, these people will, or part of these people will, dress differently. There is nothing wrong with that. They will eat different food, and the idiotic discussions about the burkini, if you go to a French beach and there is a lady in bikini lying there next to a topless lady. It's a question of taste, what you prefer. There is dangerous Islamization, incitement, hate promotion, anti-integration movements, and so on. That then slowly moves into criminal Islamization, of which terror, of course, is the main thing, and the promotion of murderous fatwas, for instance. And the Europeans haven't understood a thing, because the fatwa of Salman of Rushdie was there well before the massive integration. And they could have understood that this is a culture where you have to check very, very carefully whom you let in. It was last Wednesday night, Thursday morning, a movie on the German TV, which only in German, in which the German Jewish writer Hendrik Broder and an Egyptian who lives in Germany, Hassan Abdel Samet, together travel to look after anti-Semitism. And Hassan Abdel Samet is under a fatwa to kill him from three Egyptian theologians. So throughout the whole movie, you see him with accompanied by police guards, either German ones, or when they go to Malmö, by Swedish police guards. Now, that is, of course, that shows you the vulnerability of society. And that also shows you what a disaster it was not to select which Muslims you let in. Now, we have statistics, the ADL has done a study. We know that Algeria and Tunisia, more than 85% of the population are anti-Semites. In Morocco, it's 80%. So you shouldn't check who comes in from there. Now, you get indirect Islamization. You get people with political parties who say, well, we are fighting for the marginal vote. These people can make or break us. If you look into the 2012 presidential elections in France, the difference in votes between Hollande, who was elected, and Sarkozy, who was not elected, almost exclusively derived from the difference in Muslim votes. There was a million difference, and that was the difference in Muslim votes. So you get, then you have parties such as Dutch socialists. They have understood that you can attack Israel, and that costs you nothing, but may bring you Muslim votes. So you have this indirect Islamization, and ultimately you have, which is fastly growing, is anti-Islam movements. Now, one of the great pieces of fake news is there is something which is called an Islamist and there is something which is called a Muslim. This is total nonsense. It is an ongoing slide. You have on the one hand ISIS, murderers in the name of Muslim, and on the other hand, gradually you move on to people who are only nominally Muslim because they are Muslim born, they don't keep any of the rituals. And all this is an ongoing sliding thing. There is not a cut-off point. Here is an Islamist and there is a Muslim. Moderate Muslims are extremely weak in condemning the extremism in their parties. And we had a Dutch professor who teaches in Berlin, Koopmans, who a few weeks ago said, they are very good in going out and vote for Erdogan. So they are organized. They're very good to protest against Israel entering in Gaza. And when it comes to condemning Muslims, all these organizations suddenly don't exist. So it is not that there are not ultimately, the situation today is, today there is an increasing negative connotation, because you always run into stereotypes with the notion of Muslims in Europe. And Islamophobia exists. If you say, I'm not going to hire Ahmed because of his name, that is Islamophobia. If you say, all Jews who have been killed in Europe for ideological reasons were killed by Muslims, that's not Islamophobia, that's a fact. And I had a German Jewish paper on the phone. My guy called me 10 times, are you sure that all the European Jews who have been killed for ideological reasons were killed by Muslims? I said to him, okay, it's not that because you call me more times that the facts change. Now, look, we don't like forecasting Jews. The Talmud is fairly negatively seen, but it is very likely that problems will increase rather than decrease. Okay, Germany. Merkel says, wir schaffen das. We're going to fix it, which was nonsense already in line of the figures I have given you of Israel hate. 1 million refugees in 2015, 2016. Germany cannot cope with them. There's a book by Tenenbaum, whom I don't particularly like, but he goes through the refugee centers, and he tells the story of the poor accommodation, the fights, the problems. Now, if you bring these refugees in and you say, wir schaffen das, we're going to fix it, Germany is not fixing it. You try imposing refugees on all EU countries, which creates, of course, external tensions. And even though I am not a great lover of all the policies of all the Visegrad countries, ultimately, this may be the best countries for Jews because they don't let in Muslims. It's absurd. I mean, countries like Poland, Hungary, Czech Republic is a different game, or even Slovakia, countries with a lousy record in the Holocaust, all three of them. Now, do you get the results of that? In the September 2017 elections, the CDU, Merkel's party, gets to its lowest percentage of the votes since 1949. And it is directly linked to the refugee issue. And also the socialists who supported that go down very much. And then you get the rise of the AfD. AfD is a right-wing party. I had a lengthy conversation with the former co-leader of the AfD, Frauke Petri, when she came to Israel. She wanted to see me. We talked for 2.5 hours. I said to her, look, you can come to my home. I'm not going to be photographed with you in a cafe. but she explained the problem. She said she wanted to fight against anti-Semites. I wrote her an opinion, which managed to throw at least one anti-Semite out in the Baden-Württemberg parliament. But she has left the party because it is too left, it is too right for her. And the net result of that is, in the latest yesterday, the day before yesterday, the polls in Germany show that despite the fact that the number of, Petri is not the only one, who has left, there is in Baden-Württemberg, there is another one left, other in Saxon. Anhalt, the people have left, her husband Pretzel has left the EU, AfD faction. The AfD is rising. You have here a party with no constructive program, a party which doesn't want to govern, contrary to what Petri, she wanted to turn the AfD in a party which could govern. These current leaders do not want to govern. And despite that, the AfD is going up and the CDU is falling even below the very low figures it had in the elections. And that, okay, polls are polls and it may change, but all these are at least indicative. Okay, France. France is the sick man of Europe. Public debt, 100% of GDP, to give you an idea. Israel, which is normal, is 60%. Government spending, 57% of GDP. Israel, 41%. Annual growth below EU average, complex labor laws, high level of labor disputes, high unemployment, fragmented in the elections. Macron got in the highest presidential candidate got 25%. I mean, you had four candidates who were between 20 and 25%. And look, when I lived in Paris in this mid-60s, Jean-Marie Le Pen, if he got over 1% for the National Front, he was happy. Marine Le Pen, if she hadn't run her debate with Macron so incompetently, she would have gotten 40% of the votes in the second round. So you can see in long distance how the problem has increased. And Le Pen and her counterpart on the left, Mélenchon, together have 40% of the votes. So the future, why is the future of France of importance for Israel? Because Europe's largest Jewish community is there, 500,000 Jews. And it is our interest that the Jews who live there, as many as possible, come here and don't go to Montreal or Miami. Relationship with Israel, association agreement, we have access to the free market, we have a research agreement, various regional assessments, and we have to understand how important the European Union is, because I only have 2015 figures, about, let's say, 38% of our exports go there. Yet, the OECD says, and I'm not putting my fingers in it fire for that, because the OECD is not better in forecasting than many others, in 2050, the market of India will be twice as big as the market of the European Union. I doubt it. But at least is an indication. Problems. Europeans interfere in our sovereignty all the time. The anti-Semitic actions against Israel, the best known one is this labeling of West Bank and Golan products. Well, they don't do the same, for instance, against Turkey in northern Cyprus and another places where there is genuine occupation, whereas this is West Bank is not occupation, the Golan is. They are accommodating Islam anti-Semitism, and they look away from Arab hate. The incompetence of the EU in its own affairs makes it extremely dangerous for us. They have failed in their own affairs. Why would they know better what we should do if they were not able to know what they should do themselves? You have the external developments. Exit is the most important. You have, Obama, about whom Dershowitz said that he was the worst president in American history on international affairs. That was, he was much more liked than Trump in Europe, but Trump certainly doesn't care much about Europe. You have a complex relationship with Turkey, which also creates to you a problem in NATO. Can you give the Turkish military access to the secrets of NATO? And that is not a theoretical question after you talk with a few NATO people. What do you do with Iran? You want to do business with Iran. But on the other hand, you may have to pay for that in the future. And what is Russia going to do? Because look, if you are in the Baltics, and I was in Latvia last summer, there is a genuine fear of Russia as a neighbor, in particular because these countries have areas where Russians are a substantial part of the population. Okay, let's go to nicer things. I think that summarizes the next slide very nicely. The EU wants to wreck Brexit, but we are taking back control and doing it ourselves. What should Great Britain do? First of all, get its act together. This is a kind of war, the Brexit issue. And you have to expose the weaknesses of the EU. You have to expose the weaknesses of major EU countries. And you have to create dissent in the European Union. And you have to attack this concept of international law which the European Union threatens you. Because international law is, and there are some people here who know more about it than I do, international law is a very, very vague notion. it's obvious that we cannot get to a situation where one of the two parties at the end says we have lost. So you have to keep up the image that's a common. If the EU loses, it may fall apart. If the UK loses, has heavy economic consequences, and the Conservative Party may be massacred. And then we get Corbyn, which is a problem in itself. If no agreement, both parties may lose. And Britain has, in fact, four alternatives. If you look through all the threats, insults, remarks, articles journalists have to write, politicians have to talk, you see that the number of significant things is extremely minimal. The first thing was that Cameron called a referendum. He announced that he would call a referendum, which from his point of view may have been a major mistake. The second point is that he went to Brussels to negotiate with the EU, and the EU wasn't flexible. And there the EU made a major mistake, probably speculating on the fact that the British would vote in majority for Remain. The third major point was that the Brits voted in favor of Leave. The fourth major point was that Theresa May called an election which she handled totally incompetently. So she moved, in essence, Britain objectively had the stronger hand. Because it is one country, getting out of the EU in the short run may cost money, but in the long run will give it far more force. But if you mess up the negotiations, as they have done, then you weaken your own hand. Now the place has, Britain has four alternatives. The first one is wait for an EU mistake, which may come or may not come. The second is surrender to the EU demands, pay a lot of money because the Europeans need the money, because otherwise you get this situation that the remaining countries don't want to pay more in order to make up for the deficit of EU, UK not contributing, or and the receiving countries don't want to receive less. The third one is hard Brexit, where everybody loses, no agreement. In my opinion, what would I do? What would I do? Fairly simple. I would hire an investment banker, because these people, there is a certain similarity between corporate negotiations, big corporate negotiations, and these negotiations. And these people have experience in such negotiations. And also, they are not, in their statements, they are not dependent on political future, on their political future. They are professionals. And I have been in it, and I have worked with the major investment bankers. I mean, this is a totally professionality which the British government lacks totally. And these people will just look for what is the best way. The government doesn't have to listen to them, but at least they will explain to them what can be done and what is essential and what is secondary. Yesterday, the European Union negotiator, Mr. Barnier, the former French foreign minister, said, yes, the Brits should know if there is a hard Brexit, the British cannot no longer bring their pets into Europe. Well, I mean, these are kind of infantile games in the margin, and I don't think that the British government should be influenced by the fact whether the lab dog of a Britisher can be brought into the European market or not. Okay, so it's about money, and this one, Matt, shows it very nice. I have a pen friend in Europe. She refuses to discuss anything until I send her money. Okay. I am almost at the end. The remains, I think, what is important to Israel. What does Brexit mean for us? The UK, in its battle, will expose weaknesses of the EU, which we can exploit. We are interested, as I have pointed out, in a weakened EU. And the UK, by necessity, has to look for all the shortcomings of the European Union. The Brexit is a rehabilitation of sovereignty. And we need more sovereignty. We need less foreigners commenting on every act we do. Of course, nobody is as idiotic as the Swedes. Because Mrs. Wallström said we should investigate who has all these terrorists who are being killed. We should restrict immigration. I don't think that the people who belong to the Jewish Voice of Peace should be given the right under the law of return. And the more difficult negotiations, the more EU may pressure Israel because they need some successes. And UK is our third largest export market. And the UK looks going out of Europe for support of other countries. And that creates even bigger opportunities for us. Okay, I come back to my first slide. What should Israel do? Israel needs an anti-propaganda agency. We need more exports on Europe. How did Mrs. Petri get to me? Through an Israeli whom I didn't know. He calls me up and says, are you willing to meet her? Then afterwards, after he met, I asked him, how did you get to me? We don't know each other. He said, very simple. I looked into the English Google, and you are about more or less the only one in this whole country who regularly writes in English about European-Israeli relations, which is absurd for a place where you have 38% of our exports. We Israelis are good in looking at our own politics, looking at the Middle East, and looking at Israeli-American relations. We neglect Europe, and there we pay a price. You should establish a team to follow the Brexit negotiations. As I said, the Foreign Office should have experts for some countries, and you should investigate how to increase your sovereignty. I have almost reached at the end, in fact, reached the end, but we cannot do it without two cartoons who are this time not from Matt, but still from the Daily Telegraph. This one is Downing Street number 10. We see Theresa May, and it says, evacuation notice. It is no longer safe for you to live here. And the last one I added at the last moment because there was this absolute idiotic story of Minister Priti Patel who had to resign because she wanted the government to aid our hospitals for the Syrians. So this is the end. Well, all that is fixed now. You see Priti Patel leaving here, Theresa May standing for a house in total disorder. Well, thanks for your attention.
Okay, Manfred, thank you very much for the excellent presentation. One issue that you didn't touch was the Israel's relations with right-wing parties in Europe. In other words, parties with a Nazi past, ostensibly no longer, not still tinged with anti-Semitism, but very questionable.
It works. I'm glad that you asked that, because you know that that I have an opinion on it, and that I have discussed it with the Foreign Office. Our Foreign Office has basically a very simple position. It says if the party is boycotted locally, and if the Jewish community doesn't want it, we don't talk to them. I think that is a simplistic concept. Because not all right parties by nature are nationalistic parties. So they are not identical, and that's also why they have difficulties to create groups in the European parliament. So the our parties, we are beyond the pale. The two obvious ones are Jobbik in Hungary and Golden Dawn in Greece, which are in essence neo-fascist, neo-Nazi parties. And then you get realities which differ from country to country. The Foreign Office says, yes, we will deal with them when they come to power, because otherwise we legitimize them. I am saying to them, when they come to power, they have been legitimized by their own nation. They don't need you anymore. So there are various ways. If you're smart, you send somebody, former minister, former parliamentarian, to have contacts with these people. This is not an official contact, but you learn about the power play in these parties, and so on. It makes no sense to close your eyes for the reality. Now, if in Austria, indeed, we will soon have a government, probably of the conservatives and the Freedom Party of Strache, look, there is, as long as the people Strache sends here are not known anti-Semites, we'll have to talk to them. And Kurz, the leader of the largest party in Austria, the OVP, has said Strache has to denounce anti-Semitism, which he probably will do in order to get into the government. So, fortunately enough, some parliamentarians, Glick from the Likud, have had relationships with Strache, so that at least, and we had the same story in the past with the right-wing Italian party, who ultimately its leader became our friend. Right-wing. Fini. Yeah, okay, Fini is Finnish now, but that is. But look, you have to live with realities. I mean,
Wilders.
There's somebody whom I know reasonably well. What is the issue with Wilders? Wilders is not a genuine problem because he has. There are no neo-Nazis in his movement. He's an ex-liberal, so he comes from a democratic party. What's the problem with Wilders? The first problem with Wilders is that if he had wanted, he would have been prime minister today of Italy. But Wilders, in my opinion, of the Netherlands, sorry. And if the problem with Wilders, and I've discussed it with a number of parliamentarians and ex-parliamentarians of his party, the problem with Wilders is that he's quite happy in his current role. He's an excellent parliamentarian debater. He gets a lot of publicity. He doesn't have to take responsibility. So Wilders is for us not much of an issue. He has been here often. He has been here in his youth in the kibbutz. He is not a real problem for us. In the Netherlands, even though, of course, he is anti-Islam in a way which without difference, which is a problem. But I very much prefer Wilders over the Greens. I prefer Wilders over the Left Socialist Party. I prefer Wilders over the Dutch pro-animal party. It's all is relative. And if you ask me about Austria, I prefer Strache over Pilz of the Pilz Green Party. That's, we have to understand that our greatest enemies are very often found in social democratic parties. And look, that is not a nice picture, but Europe is not a nice picture. Look, yesterday, Katharina von Schnurbein, who is an exceptional person and who is the EU representative for anti-Semitism, said, we have to get Europe to a situation where Jewish communities can live a normal life. Well, that is a message that means that Jewish communities today cannot live a normal life. And that is Europe for you.
I would like to present a bit different analysis from what you presented. I'll present myself shortly. My name is Dr. Maya Sion-Sitkiyahu, and I'm the co-president of the Israeli Association for the Study of European Integration here in Israel. And the trends that I see with regards to Brexit is that the side that we're going to see the weaknesses, the main weaknesses, would be the UK, and we see it already, much more than the EU. And we see the EU actually growing stronger and having some sort of solidarity being rebuilt vis-a-vis Brexit. So I think Brexit is actually doing a good service for the EU, at least in the short term. What would happen in the long term, we don't know. All economists are, you know, expecting that Brexit is going to inflict very harsh economic situation in the UK, even not discussing the bill that it has to pay for Europe. So Britain lost, it always had an upper hand vis-a-vis the EU. It received many opt-outs, and it lost its upper hand. And now whoever has the side that has the upper hand is the EU. So I'm not sure which sort of Brexit we would see in the end. If, and I'm posing here a question, if, you know, we will see a Brexit, I think it would be very much, if Britain wants to save itself, it needs to cooperate with the EU and be part of the market, because as you presented the numbers for Israel, it was 37 point something percent of our export goes to the EU. In 2016, it was 42. The UK has over 40%, 45% of its export are to the EU, and 50% of its import are with the EU. So it has to find some sort of a solution, and Britain would not come with its upper hand. And Britain is the one, the United Kingdom is the one that may fall apart with regard to the Scottish and the Northern Ireland question, which is extremely delicate and problematic. And I'm not sure, on a different issue, I'm not that certain that Israel has a national interest to see the EU weakens so much. We see what a turbulent region around us with the Arab Spring. You know, it doesn't bring a lot of benefits to Israel. And I'm not sure that we want to see the EU in so much big troubles. So I would pose a question mark on that.
Look, it's very difficult to answer very difficult questions at my age. look, everybody can, of course, extrapolate what he wants. The EU, the UK imports far more from Europe than it exports to Europe. The pound has fallen substantially. All these Europeans who export, and for some regions, the UK is a very major market, will put ultimately pressure on the EU. How that will play out, if you ask me, the British have so far handled it exceptionally incompetently. That wasn't necessary. The UK needs an agreement, but also the EU needs an agreement, because the anti-EU forces are rising in a number of countries. In the Netherlands, you already have 1/3 of the population or of the parties want to get out of the EU. And the Netherlands is always a very loyal international body. The Czech Republic is another potential candidate with a very major anti-EU mood. It's very difficult. It's like playing chess. We are at the first moves, and you don't know how the game will end. I mean, maybe you're right. I don't think so, but that that remains to be seen.
Thank you, Manfred. It's always very interesting to listen to what you have to say, but I have a problem with your thesis that Europe is in trouble, like you show here. So it's looking for successes elsewhere. So it's getting more and more involved in what is going on here, interfering in Israel and so forth. First of all, I don't remember any major success that Europe had with Israel or with the situation with the Palestinians or if anybody sane in Europe can imagine that they can have any success in resolving the conflict. So what exactly do you mean that they're looking to be interfering in Israel because they would like to have some kind of success on their record?
Look, I have put it with a question mark. Look, Europe has a tremendous nuisance value. And the success they have had is that they have, in a continent of which anti-Semitism is part of the culture, which doesn't mean that all the Europeans are anti-Semites, which of course is ridiculous, but anti-Semitism part of European culture. And they have had one success. They have transformed that into anti-Israelism as a substantial part of European culture. And that that is a very major issue. Look, the Dutch writer in the movie which I saw on Thursday, De Winter, says in 50 years there will not be Jewish communities in Europe. But Catharina von Schnurbein says more or less the same. Jews, with all what has happened after the Shoah, do not live again a normal life in Europe. And that, you cannot, is that a success? But that is a fact which Europe has created. And that is a major fact. And they have troubled us. There is no doubt that they have troubled us with not voting in the UN for Arab hate motions and so on. Okay, sure, they will not get us to, which for us is a crucial issue, the negotiation with the Palestinians, they will not influence that very much. But they have caused us a lot of damage, which we do not see because you say, okay, they haven't stopped us on the ground. But that is postmodernity. It's fragmented. And you have to have a body, which we don't have, which puts all these things together and says, where are we with the EU? And they have caused us enormous damage.
Thank you. Just on the question of whether the weaknesses of the EU, the challenges of the EU are driving it to greater involvement in international affairs or the problems here. My own analysis is that the opposite is the case, and there's been a much greater focus in the last couple of years from the EU on its own internal security and political crises, and much less. And if you look at the statements from the EU Council on the Middle East peace process in the last 18 months, they're notable by their by their weakness and absence. But my question is actually more about, I'm asking if there is a tension between two processes, one of which you think is good for Israel, which is a rise in sovereignty and a weakening of the EU, and a process which I think we might generally agree is not good for Israel, which is a rise in political populism, which thrives currently on Islamophobia, but which inevitably carries anti-Semitism and negative attitudes towards Jews in its wake. And those two processes seem to go together in my mind. Those parties in Europe which support greater sovereignty and weakening of the EU are those same populist parties thriving on xenophobia right now. And is that really good for the Jews?
Look, it's very difficult to analyze due to the enormous difference in most countries between the size of the Muslim population and the size of the Jewish population. Look, we speak, okay, Norway is not EU, there we speak on 100 Muslims for every Jew. But even in France, the biggest country, we speak for 10 Muslims for every Jew. You have collateral damage with the anti-ritual slaughter movement. You have collateral damage on the circumcision. But I don't think that these things are very clear. And it also depends on how you maneuver as a Jewish community and how much Israel helps you, which unfortunately it simply doesn't. We simply don't lift a finger for these people.
Hello, thank you for your presentation, Galitonen from the Foreign Ministry, actually. And I have, first of all, I have to differ with you that the Foreign Ministry has a very simple understanding of the right-wing parties. You probably spoke to Akiva, and he's not the only one in the Foreign Ministry. And it's a little bit more complex than that, but this is not the place to elaborate about it, but I'd be happy to do that with you if you wish. The other thing is that Israel is actually very successful in helping the fragmentation of the EU and creating more chaos in that, and the Germans are actually going against that very much. But we have succeeded in dividing the EU, which makes it very easy for us and makes it easier for us to do things the way we want them to do it. It's not because of the rise of sovereignty, but rather because our arguments have been heard. And they have national interests that are similar to ours.
So obviously, when I wrote my first book on European-Israeli relations, I interviewed Mark Soffer, who said, look, all these Eastern European countries are coming into the EU. That's good for us, because these are countries who have been under an ideological reign of the Soviet Union. They have better understanding for us. And he was right. There's no doubt about that. And Bibi was right to go to Budapest to speak with the Visegrad countries. And Austria may become an interesting country, because we now people speak about Little Habsburg, Austria, and its former member states. But I don't think, look, with all that, the Europeans gave us a tremendous beating on the labeling of the goods from the West Bank and the Golan, because that was a very symbolic anti-Semitic act. And the Wiesenthal Center, my suggestion at the time, put that on the 10 largest anti-Semitic slurs of the year in which that happened. It is not, look, Israel's force in Europe, I'm not speaking about the military supplies, but Israel's force in Europe isn't really that great. And it is not such a great idea in my mind to have an English-speaking ambassador in Berlin while you have a German-speaking ambassador in The Hague. Look, you play these, and there is somebody in the Netherlands who could be an ambassador in the Foreign Office. Mm. So all these, I have spoken to a couple of deputy director generals of, because they change in an incredibly rapidly the deputy director generals for Europe in the Foreign Office. What?
One of them is in Hague in a moment.
I know, I talk to him regularly. And another one is in Oslo. So this is considered the hot seat. And life will be far more easy if you can talk to the member states, because the member states are either, most of them are our size, or they are smaller. And that's not the same if you are talking with a body which is incredibly bigger and has no responsibility towards its citizens. The supranational things, supranational bodies are by definition bad for Israel.
I know, but I have my life. I was just identifying very much with the pub. Now, Manfred, you speak about Europe as it is already dead, or it is on the verge of dying, which is something that is not so clear to me. And also, you speak about Europe as a totally lost interlocutor. there are things that convince me sometimes that there are possibilities of creating islands of sympathy. This is something that I take also from my experience, having been for 5 years in the Council of Europe. I mean, yes, it's true that generally speaking, it's not only the labeling. It's also the fact that the Europe pretends all the time to establish our borders. This is the most impossible request. They make the Massau Matan and they arrive to the conclusions and then they put it on a paper. This is the most incredible thing. What is good for us, they know it in advance. So this is a mistake. But there are groups in the military, I would like to know if you agree, in the military, in the business sector, among the intellectual, which is are really of completely different ideas. And you can make them join and discuss and go to conclusion that from time to time also arrive to an institutional level. For instance, I make you an example, and with this I stop putting use this question. In July, it was the commission that I don't know how you call it in English, la commissione speciale for the list of the for the list of the terrorist organization had to decide again for the second time if Hamas had to be put inside this list or it had to be taken out because they requested a review of the decision for several reasons. I am not going into it now. Usually this commission refuses this kind of request. At this time they have put again Hamas again inside the list. This is something very important for us because you know better than I that the discussion if Hamas is a terrorist organization is a very alive and kicking discussion, unfortunately, everywhere, also in the office itself of Mogherini, as far as I know, and I know it directly from people over there. So I would like to know for you, Europe is really without any hope. I mean, cannot we lobby inside that? Cannot we create groups of interest and of good spirit that will be in a good relationship with Israel and we change politically? You know, this is what you do politically. You do this in every parliament. You can do that.
Look, first of all, Fiamma, I think the admirable things you did were primarily in the Italian parliament where you created this incredible pro-Israeli demonstration when there were in the rest of Europe only anti-Israeli demonstrations. So that already in itself was admirable. I have said at the beginning that everything is fragmented. Obviously, if you have a counter-propaganda agency, you can do endless things. But there's no doubt about that. Of course we have friends. We have friends in Europe. And that is also what I've said. It's post-modernity. Everything is fragmented. And if you had a counter-propaganda agency, then you could do infinitely more to defeat our enemies. It's not so difficult. Occasionally I do a little pilot plant. And on the other hand, you can do infinitely more to get support. But we simply don't create the tools. We depend on the goodwill or the good actions of a few limited individuals or people. If you hadn't been in the parliament, no demonstration.
You can do that also in the European Union.
You can do a lot of things, but you have to have a body which coordinates it rather than having an endless number of small initiatives, of course. I mean, but basically, Europe is not dead. Europe is not going to die immediately. I'm only thinking that its problems will, despite that it has recovered economically in the last year or so, that it's going in for major problems which derive from its lack of foresight.
We have three questions. Can we put them together now?
I'll try.
Because otherwise, three questions. One, two, three.
I'd like just to ask you, in your presentation, you mentioned something about international law. It seems to me that the Europeans totally ignore international law, and I'd like your opinion on that.
Thank you, Manfred. You spoke extensively about Brexit, but there's another very important issue in the UK. If very few months ago you would have said that the next prime minister would be Corbyn, you would have been laughed out of court. Today he seems to be an outright favourite to be the next prime minister. What do you think, if at all, there are consequences for Israel or British Jews?
I wanted to mention two short things. And one is that the fragmentation of Europe, of the European Union, is a good thing in my opinion. I agree with you, not only because of things like the labeling, but we did not mention that the European Union is building, is helping the Palestinians build near Ma'ale Adumim and in other areas which can cause lasting damage to Israel, A, because they're building, and B, because if we destroy it, we're the bad guy. And that is a major thing that one individual country wouldn't do, but the EU as a whole can do. The other thing is that an anti-propaganda body would be quite wonderful. It's like a dream. But our media also have a big problem. There were two excellent pro-Israel speeches given in the last 10 days or so by Theresa May, who is now possibly going into oblivion, but she did give the speech, and by Nikki Haley. They were not reported in the Israeli press at all. I don't want to sound chauvinist, but the only ones who reported it are the news site that I represent.
My name is Vida Norberg. I'm a journalist. I cover a lot of the Judea and Samaria. Many travels there and knew the settlers. How can European country be such good countries and constructive countries whenever they send an ambassador here or politicians, their main thing is get out of Judea and Samaria, not build in Gilo, not build anything in the eastern part of Jerusalem. Is that really friendship? That's the kind of anti-Semitism, at least, that you see in Judea and Samaria. All are against the Jews up in Judea and Samaria, and I will ask, how can they be really friends when this is their main concern?
Many questions. International law. The European Union. The European Union, one of our better ambassadors in the past said there are two types of international law in general and international law for Israel. That's in one of my books. International law is a tool because there is nobody which really applies it. Is a tool which can be used as it suits you. The Europeans certainly use international law when it suits them, and they don't use it when it doesn't suit them. So international law isn't really an absolute given like the constitution of a country. Corbyn. Well, I was amazed. There were four studies this summer on anti-Semitism in Britain, and one of them showed 46% of the Jews in the UK have considered the possibility that they may leave the country. I was told, look, you always have the feeling when you walk through certain parts of Golders Green, and certainly when you walk through Hendon, that these are extraterritorial islands, and whatever happens in the UK is almost irrelevant there as far as Jews are concerned. And 46% is a high percentage. Look, if Corbyn arrives, I'm not saying that won't happen, but it is so unpredictable which will happen then, because the first who will be in trouble is the UK. And always remember that we speak about the Zionist Aliyah of the French. The French Aliyah is driven half by anti-Semitism, half by the economic situation of France. So if the economic situation of the UK deteriorates, that is a different story. One thing we know, that Corbyn is about the last person who can improve the economic situation in the UK with his concepts. What it means for Israel, clue, I mean, nothing good, it is obvious. I've tried to go through the men's movements in great detail, and I haven't found a single thing which is truly anti-Semitic according to the definition. All his activities are in the margins of anti-Semitism. They come very close. Here he finances Holocaust denier. There he calls Hamas my friends. But these are things which are so absurd that we haven't ever thought to put them in an anti-Semitism definition. So I don't see, I simply can't answer your question. Well, Rachel, look, the question is not friendship. There is no friendship in politics, and there has never been friendship in the past. We had a terrible ambassador of the EU here until recently, who was really, can only be defined as a disaster, because he only made enemies for the EU. If you look into the current speech of the, the Rosh Hashanah speech or so, of the new ambassador, he didn't say much. He always said, we are in favor of a two-state solution. And he and all the European countries are in favor of a two-state solution. I think many European countries don't care a damn about whether there is here a solution. But okay, that was nothing about borders. Was a very, I would say, parve speech. So that's already a great change with his predecessor. And we are, of course, you are right. What can I say?